You know I love you, bro.
Oh, God. You know I love you too, buddy.
I met the whole band and I met Dave. I just really liked him right away. Just talked and sat down and I had a drum set there and, you know, we just knew automatically that we should be in a band together and be best friends, you know.
How would you approach filling the shoes of one of the greatest rock drummers of all time?
It's intimidating, there's no question. When I joined the band, I was super intimidated because, you know, I met Axl Rose the first time and he said, "What's it like being the drummer for the greatest drummer of the 90s? I'm like, oh, hard.
After 25 years of playing drums in the biggest rock band in the world, Taylor Hawkins cemented himself as a true king of rock drumming and as an icon in the minds of drummers everywhere. His sheer power behind the drums pushed Foo Fighters to the top of the charts year after year. He may no longer be with us, but his energy, enthusiasm, and love for music will live on forever. Join us as we pay tribute and celebrate the drumming of the late legend, Taylor Hawkins.
It sounds like these time and time again.
To start off, let's talk about Taylor's signature style of drumming. He draws you in with his power, his energy, and enthusiasm from behind the kit. And really, you just can't get bored from watching Taylor play the drums. And you can even hear this come through on all of the studio recordings that he's done as well. Now, the first track that comes to mind when I think about Taylor's heavy-hitting, energetic style is The Pretender, off of Echoes, Silence, Patience, and Grace. And speaking of Taylor's power and energy, let's check out the outro section from the song Best of You. Now, there's so many interviews of Taylor talking about his influences. Drummers like Roger Taylor, Neil Peart, Phil Collins, Alex Van Halen, and Stewart Copeland. And you can hear these influences in Taylor's drumming. Even just by looking at his kit, you'll probably notice the rototoms and the concertoms, which are a clear tip of the hat to all of these drummers. With The Police, Stewart Copeland was known to use lots of syncopated bell patterns and even add toms into the grooves that he was playing, which is exactly what you hear in a lot of Taylor's parts. Now, listen to the groove in the song All My Life by the Foo Fighters, where Taylor adds the offbeat bell in bar 1 and bar 3. Now, jumping back to the record There Is Nothing Left to Lose, the drumming on the song Generator also resembles what Stewart Copeland plays on Police tracks like Message in a Bottle and Synchronicity 2. Now, it hasn't been 100% confirmed that this was Taylor on the studio recording. Only about 4 tracks on that record have actually been confirmed, but it's very likely that it was Taylor playing on this based on the playing style and the grooves and fills that you hear on the track. Here's a clip of Taylor playing it live. Another great example is from Taylor's 2016 solo record called Coda, on the track I've Got Some Not Being Around You To Do Today. But beyond the power, energy, and influences, Taylor understood what it meant to create drum parts that made musical sense. Listen to a track like Something from Nothing off of Sonic Highways, and you'll hear how Taylor develops and expands on one main groove idea throughout the entire song. You can also hear this approach in the bridge section of The Pretender, where Taylor starts with just the kick, then adds in the floor tom, followed by the offbeat hi-hats with the backbeat on the snare drum, and lastly, the full groove. This is a brilliantly crafted drum part that builds momentum throughout the entire section. Even though Taylor's claim to fame was with Foo Fighters, he actually did work with some artists before that, like the Canadian rock vocalist Sass Jordan.
Back in 1994, I was working at this music store, and I met this guy, and he said, "Hey, you know, you're working at a music store. Is that what you want to do with your life?" And I said, "No, I want to be in a big rad rock band." So he said, "Well, I know this cool chick, and she is going on tour. Her name is Sass Jordan. I don't know, does anybody know who that is here? I think you do. Okay, well this woman took some like me, 22-year-old, on the road, taught me how to be in a rock and roll band."
Taylor joined her band in 1994 to tour Europe, opening up for Aerosmith. There's some great footage from this era where you can see Taylor doing what he does best. And they also did some live TV performances as well. After working with Sass Jordan, he joined Alanis Morissette on tour in 1995 and remained a part of her band for the next 2 years until he joined Foo Fighters in 1997.
Alanis put the band together from tryouts.
And we played, and I could play it really loud and she didn't give a shit, so.
In the mail, I get a cassette of the three songs you need to know.
Cool.
The first song is You Ought to Know. And that's all you needed to hear.
Taylor joined Alanis Morissette to promote her 1995 hit record called Jagged Little Pill, which featured lots of drum machines and drum parts written and recorded by other drummers. Take a listen to the studio version of the song You Learn, and then check out how Taylor completely changes the feel of the song and adds his own spin to the drum part. Or take a song like You Ought to Know, where Taylor embellishes the hi-hat part by adding even stronger barks on the hi-hats, and then even adds in the left foot stepped hi-hat afterwards. Here's the studio version where Taylor actually appears in the music video, followed by the live version that Taylor plays. This era of Taylor's drumming isn't talked about all that often, but ultimately it's what set him up to join Foo Fighters in 1997. Now let's look at some of Taylor Hawkins' signature drum intros. Taylor had a way of creating memorable intro parts that really made a statement in the songs that he was playing. In the clip you just saw of Bridge Burning, Taylor starts the track with this intense driving snare groove with accents played on the crashes. Here's what Taylor plays in the studio version. Another great example is from the title track from the album In Your Honor. Now, even though Taylor doesn't enter with this groove until about a minute and 40 seconds into the song, this is a pretty powerful drum entrance. Here's a clip from the In Your Honor documentary showcasing the very first time the band ever played the song. Here's what the drum part sounds like just by itself. Taylor also recorded some pretty cool drum intros with his own band, the Coattail Riders. There's a drum intro from the song It's Over off of the Red Light Fever record that reminds me a bit of what Dave Grohl plays on the track Song for the Dead by Queens of the Stone Age, mainly because of the stepped hi-hats being played throughout the intro. Or listen to a track like Walking Away, where you can hear some classic Taylor Hawkins drum fills in the intro section. Taylor Hawkins came up with some incredible drum grooves, many of which you could recognize just from an isolated drum track. See if you can guess this one. So as most of you probably guessed, that was from the song The Pretender, which has this instantly recognizable kick and snare pattern. And there's so many other examples just like this one. So here we could go over a ton of different grooves, but let's start with some Foo Fighters tracks, beginning with the song Rope. So this one is clearly a tribute to the great Neil Peart, one of Taylor's all-time favorite drummers. And I know many of you know that Neil has this signature ride cymbal groove, which is exactly what you hear on Rope. The only difference is Taylor leaves out a few kick drums compared to what Neil plays. Now let's jump back to the record There Is Nothing Left to Lose, which was the very first Foo Fighters record that Taylor recorded drums on. And Dave Grohl also recorded on a few of the drum tracks as well. Now I wanted to include the song Aurora in this video because it was Taylor's personal favorite Foo Fighters track. In a 2020 interview, when asked about his favorite Foo Fighters track, Taylor said, "I would say without a doubt it would be Aurora. And that was the first drum track that I ever did for the Foo Fighters that I was really, really proud of."
There's one song on there called Aurora, which is the first song that I ever recorded. I felt like there's some good stuff. I played on Breakout and I played on MIA and a few of these other tracks on there. But there's a song called Aurora, which is, I think, the last song on that record. And that was like, that was the first time I ever went, okay, I can fit in this band as the drummer. Not just the live drummer, but I can be me and still fulfill the role of being Dave Grohl's rhythm.
Here's two other classic Taylor Hawkins grooves from the Foo Fighters record, One by One. The first groove is from the song Low. The second groove is from the song Times Like These. But Taylor didn't always stick to playing that exact groove. Sometimes you would hear him completely change it up and play something like this. Now, before we move on, let's quickly look at some incredible grooves that Taylor played outside of the Foo Fighters. Here's some examples from Taylor's band, the Coattail Riders, and a band that many of you probably didn't know Taylor recorded with, the prog rock band Coheed and Cambria. The first is from the song Louise, where you can hear Taylor playing a groove in 3/4 with a pretty cool bass drum pattern underneath. The next one is a personal favorite of mine, and it's from the song Get Up, I Want to Get Down, which is played in 7. And this last one is from the song The Running Free by Coheed and Cambria. And now for some Taylor Hawkins drum fills. And I know you all know the ones I'm talking about. We could literally spend hours going through different Taylor Hawkins fills. So here I just want to cover a few that really stand out. Let's start with some from the song Rope. As we've already talked about, Taylor was a huge fan of Neil Peart, and this entire track is full of Neilisms, including the way that these drum breaks are structured in the middle of the song. Very similar to what you hear in the song YYZ by Rush. In this section, you hear Taylor playing lots of syncopated shots on the crashes, a mix of subdivisions like 16th notes and 8th note triplets, and even some cowbell. Here's a breakdown of just the drum part. When Taylor would play this live, he would still follow the same framework for the solo, but he would get a bit creative, like you can see in this live version. Another great example from Wasting Light is the intro from the song Dear Rosemary, where Taylor uses some 6-stroke rolls with accents played on the snare and toms. Now, I think we all know that Taylor had some speed behind the kit, and you could really tell when he launched into some drum fills like this next one. Or even this intro from The Ballad of the Birds of Satan, which is a bit more of a drum solo, but I think you'll get the point. While we're talking about Taylor's drum fills, let's look at some that feature the concert toms that he had on his kit. One track where you can hear Taylor using his concert toms is the song Cross the Line by the Coattail Riders. And also on the track One and the Same by NHC, which was a project Taylor started with Chris Chaney and Dave Navarro of Jane's Addiction. One of the cool things about Taylor was the fact that even though he was in one of the biggest rock bands in the world, he was still a huge fan of music and other drummers.
This is my man cave, as they call it now. I call it a band cave or whatever. The memorabilia that I've collected over the years, from record stores or eBay or whatever. It's almost like comfort food.
And just like all of us, he still had drum heroes and inspirations. This is one of my favorite clips of Taylor performing in front of Neil Peart at Rush's induction into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
When he presented the award, the Hall of Fame award to us in 2013, and we came up on stage, he was literally jumping up and down like a you know, 2-year-old. He was jumping up and down. He was so happy. And that was him. He was so full of admiration and rock and roll joy juice.
Taylor was also a huge drum nerd, just like many of us. Just watch this clip of Taylor with another one of his drumming heroes, Stewart Copeland, and you'll see exactly what I mean.
All came from there. That's amazing. We owe it all to this humble device.
Well, that's something.
Yeah.
I never thought of it that way.
I don't think much at all.
No, I don't either.
What a lot of people don't realize is that Taylor was actually an incredible band leader and vocalist as well. Sometimes he would sing from behind the drums, like when Foo Fighters would play the song Cold Day in the Sun. Or even in the early Foo Fighters days when they would play cover songs in HMV stores. But other times, he was right up at the front of the stage, singing and leading the band, even if it was in front of 86,000 people. One track that definitely stands out to me is the song Sunday Rain from the record Concrete and Gold. This is a track where Taylor is singing lead vocals while the legendary Paul McCartney is playing drums. But even beyond all the music, it really just seemed like Taylor was an absolute joy to be around. He was always enthusiastic, always joking around and having a good time, and he really just made being a drummer look like the most fun thing in the world. And this is what we see especially in all the music videos that he created with the Foo Fighters. And if that wasn't enough proof of Taylor's infectious and fun personality, just check out these clips.
When you release an album like that, do you still get nervous, or do you just put it out there and see what happens?
I don't know, what do you think?
Yeah. Black Sabbath. They're kind of like a Zeppelin's, you know, ugly cousin.
Well, Taylor Swift just arrived and she looks absolutely amazing. Amazing. Did you see her?
Yeah, that's the Taylor that people care about.
Dave Grohl. I'm not gonna do that to you anymore.
So normally I end these videos with a quick recap of what we went over, and I talk about some other things happening here on the Drumeo channel. But under these circumstances, I really just want to take a second to talk about Taylor. And you know, these definitely aren't the circumstances I wanted to film this video under, and it's really hard to believe that Taylor's no longer with us. But I think it's important that we, as the drumming community and the music community, really take responsibility for making sure that Taylor's legacy lives on, and we remember him as the incredible person and the drummer that he was. And we want to make sure that that lives on for years and years to come. So right now, what I'd love all of you to do is really think about how Taylor impacted you and take a second to write something in the comments. You know, maybe there's a certain song that you love to jam to or that really impacted you. Maybe you went to a Foo Fighters show that you'll never forget. Or maybe you were a recipient of some drum gear that Taylor was known to buy for kids when he visited music stores. I know for me, Taylor is one of the main reasons why I started playing drums in the first place. I remember I got a copy of Echo Silence, Patience and Grace, and it was one of the very first albums that got me into playing drums in the first place. And I remember just wearing that CD out, it's full of scratches, and I would just play along to it all the time. And I even brought with me here a copy of one of the very first drum transcriptions my first drum teacher ever wrote for me of The Pretender. And I remember listening to this song on that record, and it was one of those songs that just made me want to go behind my kit and start playing drums. And that's something I'll never forget. It's the reason I'm sitting here today, and it's one of the reasons why I picked up playing drums in the first place. So please consider sharing your stories, and I would love to see the comment section full of meaningful tributes to Taylor. And with that, I just want to thank you all for taking the time to watch this video and honor Taylor and the legacy that he's left. Our thoughts go out to Taylor's family and the Foo Fighters. And of course, the biggest thank you of all goes out to Taylor for really being such an inspiration to all of us.
Tearing through the room like an F5 tornado of hyperactive joy was Taylor Hawkins, my brother from another mother, my best friend, a man for whom I would take a bullet. Upon first meeting, our bond was immediate, and we grew closer with every day, every song, every note that we ever played together. I'm not afraid to say that our chance meeting was a kind of love at first sight, igniting a musical twin flame that still burns to this day. Together, we've become an unstoppable duo, on stage and off, in pursuit of any and all adventure we can find. We are absolutely meant to be, and I'm grateful that we found each other in this lifetime.